take a look at animal totems and see what lights up, but I want to go through a meditation for that. So I'll just talk a little bit about, you know, wild animals and folklore. So you know, every animal has a powerful spirit and specific talents and abilities. You know, includes, you know, mammals, but of course, you know, insects and birds, reptiles. And again, that's because everything has consciousness. So, you know, I have a few stories about, again, it's just more communication about where, you know, animals in the wild have, you know, kind of communicated. There's times when, you know, one time we were driving from the Jersey Shore back to a Philadelphia area along Route 50, and at the time, because traffic was, you know, always bad and was in the hot weekend, everyone wants to be at the shore, we would be driving late at night, maybe around midnight, and so I was driving with my family, and we were driving pretty fast because, you know, it's so empty around midnight to get back home, and I saw a flash in front of me, just a picture, you know, in my mind's eye of a deer, and I just said to, you know, my friend who was driving, I said, you know, I think the deer, you know, up, he was going really fast, and so he's like, oh, you know, he's not deer, deer, and I'm like, it's late, and I'm like, okay, you know, well, so we're probably down, we go down about a mile, and there was a deer right in the side of the road, not on the road, but kind of just there, and it just made me think, you know, well, then the car slowed down, we slowed down after that, but, you know, it just makes me think of how, you know, that maybe they're sending out the signals, but we're really not, you know, paying attention. I mean, in our car, it was quiet, we didn't have the radio on, and, you know, we were just, you know, on some level, maybe, you know, we're just lucky to be aware, but it just makes me think of how often that might happen when they're trying to, maybe, you know, communicate with us, and they're not really in that zone at all. There's also other, I think another really interesting experience that I had was with insects, because I don't think I ever really thought that much about getting communication from insects. I never really thought very much about them. But, you know, probably, you know, several years ago, probably at least, you know, in my home in Roseville, there was, you know, a wasp that was, you know, it was in the evening, and I saw it in my house, and my first immediate reaction was, that it was mad, and that, I think, I thought, well, I'm going to be sleeping, and then somebody falling on me, so I was like, I have to kill it, you know, and then, because it was up high on the ceiling, I couldn't immediately, you know, kill it, and then I had the time to think, and I'm going, why? Why did you do it? You know, and the thing is, because I used to have a beehive just a year before, so I was like, that's in the same family, and here I am, you know, calling over my bees, and then I'm trying to cultivate them, and then I'm like, trying to kill this cousin of bees. So I thought, okay, well, I had some time. It was, you know, maybe mid-morning, and so I went upstairs, and it was Saturday, and I decided to, well, I'll just meditate. So what I decided to do was just send, you know, work on the same thing that we just did earlier, send a hello to the wasp. I sent a hello, and I said, I love you. I said, I promise I won't kill you, but if you, you know, come up, and I actually put out a picture of my bedroom window, and I just said, if you come up to the window, I'll let you go. And so, you know, I meditated for about 15 minutes, doing other things, just a general clearing, you know, for the day. And, you know, kind of got up, looked over, and there was nothing on the window. So I just was, well, you know, didn't go. So I just went on and, you know, share that story. It was just funny how those things happen, but it's just very real. But we tend to like not really want to say it because it seems really, on some level, you know, out there. And if you're, you know, go to work every day and you're not in the environment or around other people who are in agreement or aware of that, you know, sensitivity, so that you can know what animals and insects think. But it's just amazing to me how small they are, yet how aware or how, you know, they can get our attention. So that's one of my other stories. I mean, just other, you know, just dragonflies, you know, flashing dragons and hummingbirds. And there were times when I would teach transition classes, and sometimes even on conference calls so that people, wherever they are, can join in. And then I would be working to sort of set the energy before the class, just sort of looking at, like you did, what we just did, you look at a bubble. Well, I look at a bubble for the class space to see what it is and ground it and kind of just keep it clear so that it's validating for us to kind of venture in and kind of explore our intuitive abilities. And so every time when I, before I taught this class, I would be out in my garden, and every time these hummingbirds would come around, it's almost like they're aware, they're more aware than we are of when we're shifting energy into the space. So I just wanted to make sure that. So those are just a couple stories, but I wanted to really get into a little bit of just folklore and you know, definitely, you know, ancient Native American cultures, talk about the different talents of animals and insight into abilities and qualities that might be helpful to us in our own lives. So I wanted to do a brief meditation, a little bit different than the one we did before, that where we could actually just look and see, is there a particular animal totem that would be, that has some information for us right now, where we are in our lives, each in our individual lives, and is there, you know, a quality or something that might be informative, you know, for us. And so, yeah, if you just have, if you take a couple minutes and just we go into another, you know, meditation, so then it'll be a little bit different, but kind of similar. So just, you know, relax and find your, just notice where you are, take a nice deep breath. Just kind of feel the air in your lungs and just feel yourself seated in the chair. And just be behind your eyes.
distance.
That's great. That's a great spiritual lesson. I don't know. I mean, do you find that you're, that whole thing of being in non-resistance, do you think it's when you become more aware, you kind of like feel things more, and it's a real essential or important part of not resisting? Is that if you resist the things that you feel, you just, it kind of locks it in place? So it's interesting. I mean, that almost just tells me about, yeah, that a great, awareness of non-resistance. I mean, that was great that you did that and not come in fear. Anybody else? What would it be? Do you have anything else in your open and meadow? Yeah? I see, even as you were talking, it's interesting that there's channels, male and female channels that run, no matter in both men and women, we both have male and female, and that's what I was seeing, especially right across here, going over, the fifth and fourth chakra, you working or just having more balance in the qualities that are associated with those chakras, and but yeah, with just like flowing between the two. Anybody else? What? Oh, yeah. Oh, did you? What lights up, I guess, is like this fifth chakra. It's almost like being more, I don't know, you're working on being much more communicative or more open in your communication space, but when you talk about that, it lights up. It's almost like it kind of went right around your fifth. Like, you know how like an animal could, they're too big, but if they could, just lay on your shoulders, it's almost like right around your throat area. So it's the fifth chakra. I'm sorry, what? Oh, right, yeah. Yeah, but it's also about, it's almost like that, the whole dichotomy of, the coyote, I think they're very, really smart, and it's almost like complete folly to wise, so it's like the wisdom and foolishness, or it's almost like learning that spectrum. That's what I get when you talk about it. What else could it do? Or what did you, you just, what I see when it lights up your fourth, and I actually see the alligator or crocodile right here. It's the fourth chakra. It's like, I don't want to say the shadow self, but things maybe that light up fear or don't want to see, necessarily, maybe we don't want to see in ourselves, or things that are, hurtful. So it looks like it's similar to just be aware of that, or what is it that is it, can you look at one little thing that might be, your mind says is scary, but really the bigger part of you, the spirit of you, would be, space, but that's what I guess I'd like to have. And was there one that you did, what were they doing or what? You went unconscious too.
Maybe it's my speaking.
You need to maybe speak more. And now we're gonna look at the view.
You know, I see. Looks like it just. What I see lighting up is second and third chakra for the owl. I mean, I don't know why. I don't usually read things like this, but that's what's when I'm looking at you. That's what I see. So I'm just gonna read what I see. So to me, it's working, body, wisdom, the owl, the having the wide-world owl, but having your information about the physical body and then also the female body, honoring your female, honoring the body and honoring the female, yes, this lifetime, or at least this, in this moment. That's enough, what that means to you, but, and I think too, you know, when we close, I'm going to just do a last one where we look at maybe the dream space, because sometimes, you know, as you're getting new information now and you're the things that you see, the dream space is another way we can also kind of get insight from our higher self, and so we can close with kind of doing a kind of setting the dream space, and you can play around with that and see if there's what comes up over the next several days or as you become more aware of your animal totems or information from your higher self through your dream space. So you can see maybe something more will come up. It's always good when you look at it for yourself because it just has more meaning, you know, because you know. And sometimes there's things that are intangible. It's to put to words something that you might get through something that you see or for a dream. It has so much more power than you interpret yourself. So, anyone else want to share? I don't know if you meditate a lot. But when I see that, when I read, is it's you coming up to having more of your awareness of the upper chakras, the crown and the six. And it's, but you see, it's really like a rising above. So, it relates to having more of the abilities of the crown chakra, that knowing, and then the six is actually just the intuition and seeing. And I think it's releasing fear, not that you have fear, but sometimes it's just as unconscious. So it has to do with whether it's kind of safe to be, to have those, qualities and abilities. I think we've all had different lifetimes where it didn't go so well. And so there's some of those things. And just in general, we all, interact with all different people. And so sometimes it seems, that you can, be very open about your practice and meditation space and other times. So it's a combination of a lot of different things, but it's really about, for me, that's what I see rising, and it's very clear. I mean, it's interesting because the picture I saw is above the flowers, but it's like above the flowers, it's all open space. So it's really like clear seeing and clear knowing. We can probably have, maybe it's 9:25, we can do one more, right? So, okay. Thank you. inner voice. It's almost like hearing yourself or hearing yourself more clearly. But that's also like a fifth chakra ability, but an inner voice, and it's is related to the ear, but I just see clarity. Oh dear. There's some that are right back here, and they sometimes from spirits with bodies, spirits without bodies, but it's basically foreign energy, something that can come in that space. So I just see hearing that, and also just knowing more your own information, inner voice, versus what may be energies that come from another, or maybe in your aura, and it's sometimes hard to tell the difference. So I just think that it's more about hearing and knowing your own inner voice, what's you and what's not you. The insects are cool. They're all that, what do you call that, transformation, the shape-shifting, and so you were just making a statement, because it seems like you put a lot, there's a lot of big family in there, a lot of family. Yeah, really. Close by doing a little meditation about the dream space, if you're up for that, and then we'll call it a night. It's around 9:30, so keep it short-ish so we can all get home. Okay, and I had already told you the story about my pet coming back, so it's interesting that they're tremendous healers, and interesting to just really be open to however we get communication from them. So this new this next you know, final notation is really very similar to what we did before. Just, you know, we're going to create a bubble out in front of us that allows us to represent our the astral space or our dream space. And just, you know, again, can create, what we're going to do is just create a welcoming environment or an environment of openness so that we can be more, remember our dreams, be more aware of, if you choose to have animal communication or communication regarding your totem animal to come through. And I think, you know, the totem animal, it can change. You know, there probably is, you know, one for a particular lifetime, but I think it, you know, can go through different, you know, phases depending on what